to women as well to say, you know, what are you going to do about it? And for the young people, I think it also came from the aspect of understanding that leadership, you know, is such an interesting concept, and it depends on where you are looking at it from. The leadership from a man or a woman's perspective is different from a young adult perspective, and the fact that we needed to separate, you know, the work we're doing so that we can focus on what is relevant for different groups. You know, women will be more, you know, there are some things that they're very particular and concerned about, you know, things to do with family and children, and young people, there are other things that they are concerned about. So I started focusing on that. And then I realized that I had the opportunity, I think with you, you initiated, I have to say, the Excellence in Life Mentoring Program. You came, you just asked me, Adeola, are you going to be in Nigeria? And I said, yes, we were in Nigeria at the same time. And so we did that initiative in Nigeria. And I thought, wow, you know, I was in an organization where I get to travel a lot across Africa. And I thought, okay, well, how can I maximize that? Knowing that, you know, my workplace is you know, opportunity to glorify God. And I started continuing to do that mentoring. And when I look back, I now realize that, wow, you know, there's a lot of adults now in my life. So this is part of my purpose, I guess. Mm-hmm. And I started realizing that actually, you know, there's something about Africa, you know, that is important. And I started focusing on that area. So basically, I didn't start with that intention of those two groups. I think we also have the men group as well, which has not actually embedded as I thought, but is now even changing to something different. You know, and we're looking at an initiative for young boys. You know, so that is also an interesting concept as well. Yeah.
Thank you for that. Gender inequality remains an international malady, you know, and the title of this conversation is all about that. What do you think private individuals can do to address issue of gender inequality?
That's a very, very powerful, you know, question and a challenge. I was reading a report issued by United Nations Development Program, UNDP, about Gender Social Norms Index. And, you know, what the report says is that there's been a lot of work, you know, around issues around gender. And the index measured things like social beliefs, you know, how its impact on gender equality, especially in places like, in things like areas like politics, you know, education, work, and acknowledging that though the world has come a long way, you know, to ensure that women have access to the same, you know, basic things of life as men, but there's still a big gap. You know, there's still a gap in terms of access to opportunities. There's still issues around violence against women, you know, to be addressed. In some cultures, you know, it's still very difficult for women to have some particular position. So for me, reflecting on the question, I believe that, you know, we have to take it at all levels. You know, I believe that as individuals, as a woman, you know, is really being aware and engaging in the conversation. Not a lot of women actually engage in those conversations, and the women that do engage in those conversations at their circle of influence, they are seen as activists or feminists. And that also becomes a stigma. Well, you can actually engage in conversation about equality without being labeled a feminist, you know, and there needs to be a bit more engagement and conversations on that. Africa that we come from has got its own challenge because of the cultures and the norms, which is why for me, I also believe that we need to empower the next generation to go into leadership positions. The reality is, if you are not on the table where decisions are being made, you know, you can't really have an influence. And so how do we, you know, as individuals, how do we support as much as we can? I have to also acknowledge that it's not everybody that is going to bear that burden, but as an individual, as a parent, how do I ensure that, you know, I give my children the best opportunity, female and male, and how do we as leaders in organization make sure that, you know, we are providing that equal access and having the right systems in place. Government as well is made up of individuals, so how do we make sure that, you know, we are holding our government to account, even as an individual. I know we're going to, I'm not sure whether we're speaking about it, in terms of the role of young people. I think there is so much that young people can do, because we are in a generation of, I call it dispersed leadership. Leadership is not just in one individual anymore. Yes, you can have the position, but with social media and technology, we can actually hold our leaders more accountable. So it's I would just like to encourage every single person, whether you are male and women or female, to take the issue around equity and equality, you know, really, really serious. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you for mentioning the importance of education and political participation. It's very, very important. Really want to try to solve the problem of gender inequality. Somebody might be looking at this video and may want to ask, how can I be like this inspiring woman? How can I be successful like this woman? Maybe a young lady that just graduated from university and looking up to you. What are you going to tell her, or what are you going to tell a gentleman? I mean, how to be successful.
Okay. I will take a leaf from your book, Doc, that says success is relative, isn't it? So I think I for me, I think it's really important that, you know, people, anyone, a young person, being clear about what is success for you in the first instance, you know, what would fulfill you? Because that will, you know, money cannot buy joy or fulfillment anymore. We've seen that with, you know, COVID-19 has leveled everyone. It didn't matter how much you've got. And so what is that thing that will really truly satisfy you and give you fulfillment? And looking at what are you now doing about it? For me, I took the decision from the perspective of, I want to do good works that will bring praise to my God, you know, and nothing else will do. And because of that, he helped me to focus on what I'm doing and the impact I'm making. If you want to measure success by money, I wouldn't say I'm a millionaire or, you know, but I'm a millionaire in terms of, you know, joy, you know, and satisfaction and peace, you know, and I love empowering others. I love that it gives me that satisfaction. So I always encourage the young adults to really have a clear vision of their life. You know, if having millions in the bank is what is important to you, is what you will make you, you know, content, is asking yourself, you know, if you have million in the bank and you don't have health, what would that be? What would that be? Because money can buy everything. But if you help somebody, you know, in whatever way, and that person comes to you with so much thanksgiving, there's a different kind of satisfaction. So be clear about your vision. Educate and get educated. I think, you know, there's so much to learn. There's so much, you know, to contribute to. I think one of the things that I always argue with people, especially concerning Africa and Nigeria, is that sometimes we argue without knowledge. You know, if you want to have credible, intelligent, you know, debate with people, do it from a place of knowledge. So educate, read news, you know, be involved in what's going on. So much is changing in the world right now. And, you know, this is even something that will really help you when, if you are going for a job interview, you know, the sort of, you know, worldview that you have. And I will also say, you know, get good mentors. Even in right now, I also have mentors. You know, it's always good to have mentors, not just to learn from them, but to also have accountability from somebody. Somebody that would, you know, there is not about their own interest, because mentor is meant to help you, so that you are, you know, accountable to them, and that accountability is about them helping you to, you know, achieve success or excellence in life. So have mentors, good mentors, and make excellence a life standard. You know, it's mediocre is not good enough. You know, and I think sometimes we can have a laissez-faire attitude to what we do. You know, if that is not a reflection of success or excellence, if, you know, the quality of what you do is not so poor. So I think, you know, for me, success is also about, you know, having excellence as one of your values. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Gabriel left a question on Facebook when I announced that I'll be doing this interview. He sent this question: how can Nigerian youths in particular and African youth in general be empowered, taking into consideration failed leadership across Africa and also confronting dilapidated infrastructure all over their country?
Yeah, that's such a contemporary question, isn't it, about Africa? I was reflecting on that. You know, there's different ways to look at it. There's the way of reality, pragmatism, and optimism. Reality is that, you know, some of the problems that we have in Nigeria and in the continent of Africa is about leadership, governance, and is about infrastructure systems and structures that are in place. Those things cannot be changed overnight. You know, change, you know, takes a good change. If you look at, you know, what happened in China, took 20 years, you know, for us to start seeing it, for the country to change. So the change is not going to happen overnight in the country or the continent. That's the reality.